Hi, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of the Critical Podcast. My name is Jimmy Good, and I am your host, but I'm not your only host, because I'm joined, as always, by my go-to podcast compadre, Mr. Joe Lever. Joe, how are you doing today, pal?
Doing daggone baggone great.
Oh, that's a really daggone baggone great. I really like that. That's that rolls off the tongue in a way. Well, yeah, thank you.
Happy hump day, my friend.
Oh, same to you. Yes, I was like, wow. Oh yeah, Wednesday reminds me of the camel stuff. You know, those old like kind of jokey movie things.
Mike.
Yeah, exactly. But yes. So anybody who is returning, thank you so much to our Legionnaires, and thank you for anybody who's tuning in for the first time. If you're joining us for the initial experience, as it were, we talk games, TV shows, movies, all the things, the time killing things that we love so much. But no, we're not getting into Time Killers quite yet because that'd be jumping the gun. But anyway,
Time Killer. Oh
got sorry. I'm not editing Time Killers in there, all right? Maybe I will. Who knows?
I jumped the gun. My bad.
So, Joe, because last week we did rapid fire news, which was really rapid and we went by so quickly, we're going to do it again, but we're legitimately going to do it in rapid succession. And all I want from you is just a brief just reaction. I don't care what it is. I don't need any more than that. Just a brief reaction. Does that make sense? All right, okay. Here we go. First off, Logan, which we're going to be talking about today, makes $85 million in its first weekend, which is less. Deadpool made $132 million, but still, that's pretty dang good. Joe, how do you feel about this?
Well-deserved.
Well-deserved. Okay, pretty good.
Yeah. I didn't expect it to blow anything out of the water.
Sure. Yeah, a little more somber. So get this, Joe. Alien Covenant, there's already a sequel in the works for it before this movie came out. What do you think?
Yes! Yeah!
Oh, God.
That's what's up.
I should have known you would have been excited. Yeah, well, that's good, you know, for Alien fans. You know, it's just saying.
Alien will never die. It's a classic, and it just keeps on going.
Yeah, it just keeps coming back. Those xenomorphs, they just keep making more facehuggers. How do they do it? I don't know. Biology, I assume.
Mm-hmm.
If only I had a degree in it. Anyway, moving on. Inhumans, Joe, the TV show that Marvel's making, this kind of big production, just started filming in Hawaii. And on set, they have this gigantic blue dog, which is going to represent Lockjaw, which is a teleporting gigantic dog. How do you feel about this? Just like, what the heck? Yeah, Lockjaw, he's like this gigantic dog with the Inhumans. It's very confusing. We'll explain it one day. But I
will refrain from commenting on that one, Jimmy.
Well, Joe, we're going to have to see this. The first two episodes are going to premiere at IMAX. So if you want to see the first two episodes, that's apparently the best place to do it. See a teleporting dog that's gigantic.
Named Lockjaw.
Named Lockjaw. He bites you if that's also what you get. But you know.
Okay. Yeah. I won't delve into that any further or make any strange comments. Interesting. Cool. Okay. And I like a couple episodes premiering on IMAX. That's cool.
Yeah.
Way to really bolster it up, huh?
Up the stakes for sure. It's not like they premiered Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. They're like in IMAX. You're like, I like Phil Coulson, but I don't need to see like 90 feet of Phil Coulson. And the last bit of news, Joe, that I thought you might be interested, Jared Leto possibly starring in a new Tron film.
The first Tron was stupid. The second one is going to be stupid. Well, is going to be stupid.
By first one, do you mean Tron Legacy?
Yeah, whatever it was. I don't know.
There's one in the
Jeff Bridges is in it, isn't he, or something?
Yeah, but there's one back in like the 1980s as well, too, like the original Tron. I don't have to fact check these things. I just wanted a feel for Jared Leto saying like you might go and do this. I feel like Disney's just going to court him to play another Joker type in like Marvel, and this is just the way to get him. Oh, we know DC hurt you. Just come over here. It's okay. You can be in Tron. And they'll just kind of hug him for a bit. And Mickey's just like, oh. You know, just kind of snickering off to the side. No, Mickey's subtle. He wouldn't laugh like that. But anyway, do you even care? Is this something you even care about? I know last time we saw him was Joker in the Suicide Squad.
Listen, Jared Leto is a class A actor. He's great. He's awesome.
Yeah.
I think if they kept going with Joker with him and actually did the right things with the character itself, I think it'd be awesome. Tron, I could care less about.
Yeah, I'm kind of with you there, though, too.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry.
You couldn't care less about it, would you say?
I couldn't care less.
There you go. Yeah, we'll see. I don't know.
I've already wasted too many brain cells on it, Jimmy. Let's move on. Rapid fire.
That's it. That's the rapid fire news of this week. That's all I want to get through. Yeah. I'm sorry. We can do this every week, though. I think it's a fun way of getting just like cranking through it.
Hey, like I said, though, Jared Leto, class A actor. I think his portrayal of the Joker was very, very original. But also, you know, he made it his own, but it was also very symbiotic of the true Joker character from the cartoons, the comics.
Yeah, it was like a weird amalgamation, and I think that if it were a better film with better writing and kind of better editing process, I think we would have potentially gotten to see what the true purpose of that character is, because apparently there's a lot of information that they left just on the cutting room floor. So
I hope that contract is, you know, locked away somewhere and written very well. And guarded by a team of lawyers, because I want him to keep going with it.
Well, I don't know. We'll see if he comes back. Because the next time we probably would see him was potentially in the Batman standalone, if not in Gotham City Sirens, which either case, it would be excellent just to see him get another crack at it if he wants it. But I'm not sure at this point. We'll see. We'll see.
Yeah.
So it's not like he's a, like you said, he's a very good actor. He's very talented, but he's very picky about the films he does. And I think, If you burn an actor like that, it's hard to get them back to talk with you. So
yeah, I mean, he's a Oscar or Academy Award, or what's the word? What's the award that actors win?
The Oscars,
Emmy,
or wait, Emmys for TV, SAG awards.
No, he won. Is it an Oscar? Actors win Oscars too.
Like
best female actress in a drama. Yeah. Okay.
Yep. Or well, Academy Award. It's the same.
Yeah. Make up your mind, guys. Come on. Anywho. No, I mean, that's the type of actor he is. I mean, he's in the running for stuff like that when he does a good film, and you know, they should do him justice with the characters he plays. He doesn't want to sign on to something that's not worth his time.
Yeah, definitely. And these movies, two, for like we said, he's very picky. It's hard because they want to sign you on for like 10 of them. You know, they want to say you're our Joker, you will be our Joker for the next 15-20 years, you know. And that's that's a scary prospect.
Problem is, DC steps on their own willy right out of the gate, you know. Come on.
Well, not right out of the gate. We're gonna talk about Man of Steel here in a second, but you know, with this BVS stuff, I don't know, Joe. Anyway, that's rapid fire news. See, so other people were thinking we weren't going to be quick this week. Look how quickly we took care of that. But Joe, 25 episodes ago, and now it's 25 episodes from that, we like to do this thing called the quarter yell. And for anybody who's new here, the quarter yell is based mostly on just like, not on the Hunger Games where it's the quarter quell where they're killing a bunch of people, but I liked the name and I thought, what could we do every 25 episodes, every quarter as it were, to kind of spice it up a bit.
Wait, so Jimmy, what episode are we on? Are we on the 50th?
We are on episode 50, believe it or not.
Dang on, man.
We'll talk.
Happy 50th. Should we get a party together?
Well, I think we should do that for when we do the full year, and that's
centennial.
Yeah, well, we started talking about doing the show, and we did the first podcast on like Batman vs. Superman, I think. I'll have to go back and look, but I think that was kind of like the first one we did together, Joe.
Probably.
But anyway, so at 25 episodes ago, we did this. We're doing this again, and so Joe and I are going to go back and forth. We're just going to yell out an opinion, and we get two of these, what I call hold-its. So you only get two. So we'll go back and forth, and if Joe says something where I think, hold it, explain. But when you burn up your hold-its, you can't use them anymore. So if Joe says something completely insane and I can't stop him, or if I say something where Joe's like, oh, what the heck, I disagree with that, you can't use it unless you have a hold-it, so you only get two. So we're going to go back and forth, and hopefully this time we're going to use opinions as opposed to facts, because facts aren't as fun as opinions. So remember, these are our opinions. These are not completely indicative of what everybody thinks. So don't get really, like, if Joe says something or if I say something, you're like, how dare they? That's just how we feel. So, but I want you guys to, you know, feel free to tell us in the comments below. Shout an opinion. Like, if it doesn't even, we don't care what it's about, but keep it to movies, TV shows, and games. We don't need to get political or anything crazy up
here. It's going to be huge.
Exactly. Huge. That was my concern, is that it was going to be like, whoa. So, Joe, Do you have anything you want to start us off with, my friend, for our quarter yell, as it were? Don't be afraid to get loud, Joe. These are opinions. You want to shout them from the rooftops.
I have to start off with this one, Jimmy, because it's signatory to who I am and what I do every week on this podcast.
I'm not going to waste a hold it on this one, then.
Canada Dry Ginger Ale is the best soft drink ever invented.
It's my turn. Man of Steel is by far the best film the DCEU has ever put out, ever.
Pull it.
You're using a hold it on Man of Steel, Joe? What's wrong with you? You love Superman. What the heck? Okay, what would you say is better?
My hold it is I want you to explain it more so that people can hear you.
Oh, well, Man of Steel is pretty great. I think as a Superman origin film, it has its flaws. One of them being how Jonathan Kent dies. It's kind of stupid because then, like, a few years later, he kind of reveals his identity. Could have saved his dad. But it's a really cool telling of that story. And also the beginning, too, the Krypton stuff is really fascinating. I love seeing that world and kind of like a modern take on it. It's really, really cool. I think, I can't think of his name right now. Russell Crowe is a kind of a cool Jor-El, and that whole back and forth that Jor-El has with Zod in the beginning really sets up that confrontation later on. And I think Zod's actually a really cool and fascinating villain. You feel kind of bad for the guy because, like we talked about before, he's been born to do this type of thing. He wants to protect Krypton, and now he's got a second chance at it after kind of being exiled before Krypton gets destroyed, and Kal-El is the only thing standing in his way. So his priority in life is just resurrect Krypton by whatever means necessary, and if that means killing every human, he'll do it. And I love Zod for that. He's really cool. I think Henry Cavill is a pretty good Superman. We haven't really gotten to see him at his peak yet of kind of that hope and that prosperity that I think kind of Superman embodies. But I'm hoping we get there soon. So he's great. I think the action is really good. I know a lot of people had a problem with that. But I really think that's what would happen if you put these super powerful people in a place where there's all these other just regular folks. People would die. There would be tons of collateral damage. And Superman's not going to be able to stop that. You know, he's going to have to go, you know, past that line. He's going to have to do something he doesn't want to do. And that'll help shape him down the line. So that's what I think. And that's why Man of Steel is the best. Also, it's its own story. You could watch that by itself. You don't need anything else. It's just like, hey, here's Superman. You don't have to say, oh, do I have to watch these other two? It's like, nope. So, there you go.
Brandon Routh.
Oh, poor Brandon. Hey, no, actually, not poor Brandon. He's freaking in the CW, so whatever. He's fine.
Is he really?
Yeah, he plays the Atom. He plays he plays that scientist. He's basically like Ant-Man. He could shrink down or get like a giant man.
Oh, that's him?
Yeah.
Oh, that's him.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yep.
Jeez. Learn something new every day.
There you go.
He's aged well. I'll give him that.
Yeah, he's a good-looking guy.
Jimmy, well said, pal. Moving on. We got to get back after it.
Yeah,
Ghost Recon Wildlands is the best co-op video game, second only to Grand Theft Auto V.
Hold it. What are you ever? You mean ever?
Okay, hold it. So, in my opinion, because it's only, oh man, I might have got myself in a corner here.
Yeah,
good, hold it. Holy man. Okay,
I gotcha.
Of that style of gameplay, I don't think I compare it to something like Overwatch, where it's just a shooter. You develop tactics and stuff, but it's fast paced. I'm thinking more, you know, I'm comparing it to games similar to it. And really, the only ones that I've played are Grand Theft Auto, not just Five, this one, and then what else have we played, Jimmy? I'm trying to think.
Evolve. You could say Evolve.
Exactly. That was another one. I couldn't think of the name. Anywho, reason being, well balanced.
Mm-hmm.
Everything works. Mm-hmm. Open world objectives. Beautiful to look at. and just overall storyline. Storyline's actually pretty good. You know, we were even playing the beta. We got a little ways into it and, you know, did all the missions and taking out that old special ops American general, or not general, American sergeant or whatever, who, you know, took up, so, you know, took, saw the dollar signs and, you know, started working for the drug gang cartel. Sorry. The storyline's there. I think it is. And I think as we get in that game more, it's going to get even better. The reason that I still hold GTA 5 at a high level, you know, they're almost equal, but GTA 5, for some reason, the helicopter controls, the plane controls, perfect. It's all there. I like the fact that it just has a – I like the fact that when you're online with your friends, you also have to interact with other online players.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, which is probably a lot to handle for any you know, server or system. So I have a feeling that's why it's tough with, you know, getting on with your friends and online play, which is the only fallback for that game, I feel.
Yeah,
I know. Other than that, it's kind of like an actual role playing real life thing. I know, you know.
I was like, my connection issues are always the absolute worst of that game.
I don't have a lot of issues. Generally, it just seems when I'll be able to get with one friend, but it's always that third person trying to get them in is always tough. But, you know, all that considered, you're interacting with real people in an open world, and it's kind of real life. You're selling things, you're buying things. There's actual monetary value to stuff. I think that's fun. You have your own headquarters as an apartment or a house, etc. You can start a biker gang as a side business sort of deal. Stuff like that. And then the little Easter egg type stuff, you know, with peyote in the career mode and things of that nature. The career mode is good. So, you know, that's why I kind of hold that above it still. And there's a lot of weight there to that game. But this Ghost Recon is just, it's top notch. They did a really good job. And I can't wait to get more into the storyline. So, yeah. And I like the balance of it and the, you know, the same kind of aspects of GTA 5. So I love that game in the same way that I love that game or GTA 5, because it shares a lot of common ground.
Yeah, makes sense.
So, yeah, all right. Long-winded, but moving on.
Good explanation. All right, Joe. Well, it's funny that you mentioned something like that. Well, no, I'm not even. I'm just going to say what I'm going to say here. Horizon Zero Dawn features the best open world since The Witcher 3.
Good on you. Yeah, it's a awesome looking game.
These are my opinions, Joe, not yours.
I was just nodding in agreement. Apple, iOS operating system, iPhone, best cellular device out there.
Oh, I wish I could just, we should make a refute it point. Anyway, okay, Joe, get ready for the hatred. Walt Disney Animation Studios, Moana, Zootopia, and Tangled have created everything, and everything that they've made is better than anything Pixar has ever made. Take that. Is he going to use his hold it? I don't know if he's going to do it.
Hold it.
Oh, Joe, you just had to do it, didn't you? You had to spring the trap, didn't you?
The people want to know.
All right, Joe. This is purely opinion-based, obviously. And I know a lot of people out there love Pixar, and I understand why you do. Pixar's got a lot of good stuff. But I did this earlier today, where I looked through Pixar's backlog. Great.
Okay.
Okay. Toy Story. Obviously, a lot of people like that. Okay, great. You know, people, Toy Story, I think Finding Nemo and Up are the three that right now roughly seem to be the biggest ones. Maybe not Up as much, but Toy Story and Finding Nemo are like the, I don't know, man. I feel like they double down too much on it. Toy Story 2 and 3 aren't really superb. I do like Toy Story 2's villain, but I love Kelsey Grammer, so that's just, and Toy Story 3 seems like a rehash, and it's kind of like, Nazi Germany. Not that, I don't know, it doesn't seem like it's really new. Some of the other things they've done here are kind of interesting, like Bug's Life. I love Incredibles, but that's just because, you know, I'm a big superhero fan. But a lot of this other stuff is not that great. Good Dinosaur, Wall-E, I'm sorry, not that great. Monsters, Inc. was okay. Monsters University, not superb. Inside Out had a great idea. I don't know if it really fulfilled on that. Cars, not superb, really. I'm sorry. But then you look on the other hand. I didn't even bring up Frozen. I know a lot of people, it's like you either love it or hate it, but that was a very well done film. I think the thing with Walt Disney for me, animation studios, is that they've taken the old cartoon style and they've applied it to that kind of the computer animated style and kept the songs and everything, and it's still applicable today. You know, you got that. Zootopia doesn't really have songs like that, but it's also a really great film. Moana is fantastic. Tangled, like I mentioned before. Wreck-It Ralph is like a celebration of video games. They've just been cranking it out, and they've been doing really, really well. And I have a hard time looking at both of these things. And then you look back at Pixar, like Cars 2, Brave. It's just not like, I'm sorry, Ratatouille, it's fine. It's just, I have a hard time looking at Pixar and saying you are as strong as Disney, Walt Disney Animation Studios right now. That's all I'm saying. So, except even though my statement did say that they're making better things than anything they've ever done, I like the stuff that Disney's doing better. I'm not a huge Toy Story fan. I think it's kind of tired after the first like 10 minutes. I'm sorry. And it doesn't look that great anymore. I'm also sorry. It's just the truth. That's how I feel. So there you go. Come at me, Pixar. You're like the Apple of freaking movies. Not that great. I got to dig in on Joe's phone after all. All right, Joe, it's your turn. You used your last hold it. Now I can say whatever I want. I saved some Superman things just for this.
I'm just kidding. I knew it.
It's my super might master plan. Let's do one more. Let's just do one more. I'm sure really people are angry at
Pokemon Go is the most overrated and stupid game of the entire year. 2016.
Okay, I have to. I'm just going to say hold it. I want to use my other hold it on this one. Pokemon Go is the stupidest game this entire year. What is it just because it's just like a walking game? They just put Pokemon on, got people to walk outside. That's a great thing, Joe. Getting people out there, walking about.
Part of it is, you know, I downloaded Curiosity.
Yeah, I did too.
As a general human being...
Oh, this is good. Who's
functioning in life and actually doing things, has time to devote to catching Pokemon and just having them. I look at how many I have. They're just here. And then if you want to do anything with them, you got to go to a church. What's Pokemon trying to do to us here? Huh? Don't you push your religion on me.
This is so good. Not only have you... insulted like the biggest game of the year, you've also made a vast assumption about all normal human beings, and that Pokemon Go is actually some sort of like trick by the church to get everyone to go to church.
I'm telling you, man, I'm pretty sure the church is ganged up and they're like, hey, Pokemon, Oceanic, we gotta get all these people.
The Pope's just sitting there, he's like, why couldn't we call it Pokemon?
Like, Pokemon.
Can't do that, sir. I'm sorry. Okay. Fair enough. I get that. There's definitely people who spent too much time on that. Like any game, though, there's some people who have like incredible levels or just like multiple thousand levels.
And the issues it caused with trespassing and bullcrap and cops wasting their time, our tax dollars at work sort of a deal. It sucks. It just created too many issues, and keep it to the freaking Game Boy. All right, guys.
Would you say at the very least, though, it was kind of cool that it got a lot of people who don't necessarily exercise or go outside for video games?
There are genuinely good aspects of it. However, there was one point where I had left it open and I was driving home from work and I pulled up my phone because I was going to call somebody and it's open. I'm like, oh my God, look at that Pokemon nearby. And I'm like, what the fuck am I doing? My phone down. I was like, this is bull crap. Next day, gone. I deleted it.
I think it's say, I put my phone down after I caught that Cubone, And I drove home and said, I'll never do that again. Caused multiple car accidents. Just like, I will catch you.
I heard screeching, but hell, I got that Cubone.
Yeah. Oh, man. Okay. Fair enough. Good explanation, man. I appreciate that.
I like that it did involve real world application to a video game.
Sure.
But yeah.
Sure. All right.
I didn't have time to open it and actually pay attention to if there was anything around me. I never had time for that.
Yeah. Well, you're unlike a lot of people who constantly seem to be like this when they're out with other people.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, you ever bump into me on the sidewalk and you're looking down at your phone, I'm going to slap your phone right into the concrete. I'll tell you what.
I guess don't run into Joe with your phone. Would you do the same thing? If someone's reading a book, like, you know, kind of bell, they're like walking around with the book, they just slam the book on the ground. You're like, bookworm, would you sit down, man?
Nerd! <Yeah. laughs> Find a locker to stuff them in or a blue mailbox, post office box.
Yeah. My goodness, you're not a jock thing to do at all. I'm walking here. I need this whole sidewalk. I'm a broad-shouldered individual. Get out of my way. I need to eat my Diet Canada Dry.
My shoulders need space too, asshole.
Oh, man, wow. That's feeling good. All right, Joe. All right. I have one more for you here. I had a few more, but I think one more is going to be good because it kind of ties into one I had before. But anyway. The Leshen is the coolest monster in all of Witcher lore. And you can't use the hold it on it, so that means it's true as far as this podcast goes, because this is an opinion-based.
I don't need to hold it. That's awesome. I would have said that one if I would have played the game, but I've seen the animations of the monsters in there, and that one is awesome.
Leshen, so cool. Yeah. Cool.
I love artistic style like that. I think it's really cool.
Yeah. Well, Joe, there it is. There's our quarter yell. I hope that you got some opinions out there you really needed to express to people. I know I did. I'm sure I've
really needed to get that off my chest.
Yeah. I can already see the comment section now. They're like, how dare why do you
how
hate
dare you? Pokemon Go was the greatest thing of all time. I'm still playing. Level 1,000.
They'll be angry at you for Pokemon Go. They'll be just furious with me about Pixar. But that's okay. If you love Pixar, and these opinions, again, are our own. They are not fact. They are just, these are just things that we hold near and dear-ish.
I want to know what people think about the cell phone opinion.
Oh, huh? The cell phone thing. That's a good one. I want to see what people talk about if they're really pro Apple or pro Android or pro brick, if they just don't want to use phones. They're like, oh, look, this brick.
little side note for you. So I just recently, I had a colleague who got a new work phone for work, and he ended up getting the iPhone 7 Plus. Just like mine, and he used to be a Android user, all Android stuff, and he comes up to me yesterday. He's like, man, I see why you like your iPhone so much. This thing, like, it's fast, everything works the way it's supposed to, it's intuitive. You know, if I need to send something, I need to attach this to it, that to it, whatever, and send it off. It works. The options are there. You know where they are because it's easily laid out. Can't go wrong.
It's simple. Yeah, definitely. It's very straightforward, wouldn't you say?
Yeah. All the while still having a very appealing design, lots of cool features to it. So,
well, Joe, you know, it is straightforward. It's cutting edge, and it's kind of like one of my favorite superheroes, actually, the Wolverine. You know, he's those slicing things as and well. Dicing. Flawless transitions.
Can't open her knuckles.
Can't open.
Open a can's of whoop ass.
Did you come up with that on your own?
Yeah.
That's really good, dude. I really like that.
Come on, I'm creative once in a while.
I just, when it happens, it's like I am
insulted.
I caught that polar bear in the blizzard, you know? It's like, I know it's there, but I never know quite where. Anyway, but Joe, we both saw Logan last weekend, and I kind of want to talk about it a little bit. We'll go into spoilers eventually, but I kind of wanted, if you wouldn't mind, give us just a brief synopsis of what happens in Logan. so that people who might be interested, they can say, oh, maybe I'd see that, or maybe I wouldn't. Because honestly,
you know, you're asking the wrong person to do this, right?
I want it to be like...
You asked me for a brief synopsis. I gave a play-by-play of the entire two-hour
movie. Doctor Strange, you were talking about how he was like kicked out and sitting at the door. I was like, this is very small. You need to get to the bigger picture. I'm thinking three or four sentences, you know, just... A quick, like, if you wanted to get me into the theater, what would you say?
All right, Logan, Mr. Wolverine, the one we know is Wolverine from X-Men. The guy's driving around a limousine for cash, trying to save up his dough. He's peddling drugs for the old ball, cue ball. He's stowing Professor Xavier down in Mexico, across the border. He's working in Texas. So the whole idea is Mr. Xavier's having issues and, you know, hurting people with his mind because he can't control it, seizures, the whole kit and caboodle. They're saving up for a boat, you know, go out to international waters, live their life on the water, whatever, so that he's far away from people, less brain noise, all that good stuff, right? Okay, great. Some nurse from some American company that had a research facility in Mexico where these things were, you know, they passed under the law. There was really nothing to control it. So they had it in Mexico. They were doing experimentation with creating their own mutants through using the DNA of other mutants that had since been eradicated. So one of these mutants happens to share Logan's DNA, technically his daughter. The nurse steals them when they quit the program. She finds Logan. She's like, I'll give you all this money if you take her to Canada. There's a safe haven. Logan's like, no, fuck you. He's like, yeah. Finally, he gets a call. He goes and does it. Takes him and the professor. They get about to Kansas or something like that. And professor,
and that's all you need. We don't so remember, spoiler-free up until this point, except you've already divulged major spoiler. No, just they're on the run. They're trying to get to Canada. That's all.
Yeah, they're trying to get to Canada. They're on the run.
That's all you need if you want to sell me on the movie. If I'm not sold at this point, then you know.
Okay, so let me at least say this. If I'm gonna sell you on the movie, for an old dude, the guy can go buck. I mean, he still can swing a claw or two, you know what I mean? He's gotta pull him out of his hands these days, but
yeah,
he'll slice and dice a bit and it's pretty awesome, and I tell you what, I don't think there's anybody that can portray that character as well as Mr. Hugh Jackman.
Hugh Jackman?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. He's great.
The guy just kills it, and it's intense. Through his character alone and his acting, it's intense. You know, I saw your review. You talked about, slow moving here and there. Slightly. But it was always leading up to a explosive scene sort of a deal, and it's pretty consistent throughout, I feel. I mean, it's kind of nice not to have a slew of mutants. You know, you got the kids that are trying to make it up to Canada, but that's about it. And FYI, all those kids with those powers, they couldn't do anything to, like, help. I think one of them dropped a truck on the one guy, but that was about it. Yeah. I mean, come on.
That's true.
Come on.
They're scared, Joe.
Freaking, hey, little Frozone girl with your freezy breath. Just freeze that bastard and, you know, shatter him into pieces. Come on.
Oh, this is so good. That's great. Like you mentioned, I had reviewed it, so if you want to see more of my thoughts, I kind of want to get more of yours too, but I kind of akin the movie more to like a Western film, so compared to its modern day equivalents, it has a slower pace to it, and there are some times where it does they just kind of hang out and they talk for a bit, and it's very, it's just a slow pace to it, you know, and that's not necessarily a bad thing, it can be off-putting, I think, to some people who might go in and think, oh man, the trailer showed he's like killing everybody all the time. That is not the case. He's not fighting constantly.
Well, and you can tell really their main goal here was to do the character justice. It's kind of his last hoorah, so to speak. And I think they do that. And those slower, more dialogue-based scenes are setting it up for that ending of, you know, closure for Wolverine and Logan. So,
yeah, we'll go full spoilers now for if anybody's got to this point in thought or not. But we'll just say that they... We are.
All right, full spoilers from this point on. Turn it off right now if you don't want to hear it. But can you believe freaking Professor X dies?
Yes, because in Last Stand he does, and I remember thinking, oh, this was a more emotional version.
Last Stand? What the hell?
Yeah, he explodes.
When did that movie take place?
Well, the timelines...
After this?
No, before this, but the timelines are all messed up now.
So why wasn't Logan old and brittle in that one?
Because that one took place like right after X2, kind of. It's very confusing. Try to make me understand it.
So somebody with mutant powers brought him back together, grabbed all the atoms, and made another Professor X, and that's why we see him in this movie, huh?
No, the reason you're seeing him in this movie is A, because they kind of retconned some of that with Days of Future Past, or B, because he transferred his consciousness into some husk of a man that looked just like him in the end of X3. It's very confusing. It's dumb. It doesn't make a lot of sense. The thing that was weird to me most about Professor X is the guy's got a mouth on him. I've never heard this guy go off more, and it was so weird because this guy is kind of a... I know he's disheveled and old, but it's nuts.
But my thought on it is that, you know, his proper mentality has gone out the window. He's on his last leg. He just doesn't give a shit anymore.
That's true. I kind of wish we'd get...
Wolverine, the guy should swear. He's freaking Wolverine.
Yes, Wolverine. I completely agree with you. There's just that moment when he's watching or he's talking about Laura or X-23, the girl, and he says talking about the like the lions and stuff like that, and how female lions have they're the hunters and the den mothers and all that stuff, and the claws on the back feet or whatever. I thought that was really cool because that was a Professor X type moment. Just because it's R-rated doesn't mean everyone in it needs to be R. So my example for you, Joe, is going to be if they have them make that Venom movie, and if they made it R-rated. I don't want Peter Parker or even Aunt May to be like, son of a, and they just keep swearing the whole time. It's like, I don't need that.
Like, Peter, you got to kill that mother bleeper.
Yeah. That would be a great Aunt May line, though, wouldn't it?
Aunt May, this guy's a piece of shit.
Peter, like 17-year-old Peter Parker's just cussing off the handle. He probably would. I think Wolverine doing all that makes perfect sense, and I think that was closer to his comic book counterpart. Which is great because Hugh Jackman, I think one of the criticisms, even though he's an excellent, excellent Wolverine, is that he isn't really the embodiment of what the comic books are. Because that Wolverine's like not a pretty man and he's kind of gruff and gritty and he doesn't really care about all this other stuff as much as this version seems to. Because they've kind of built this whole franchise around this character. So he kind of has to be a little more empathetic. Whereas Wolverine, I don't think is always that way. I don't know. I haven't read all the comics, but... It'd be interesting to see where they go.
Bring a sense of realism to it too. I mean, the guy's gonna be off the rails and kind of gruff and angry sometimes, but I mean, at certain points, I mean, the guy's still human. He's got to have some sort of feelings towards things.
Yeah, he's just the prettiest.
And it wouldn't be much of a movie, right? It's like,
yeah, true.
I accidentally sliced through that little girl's throat as I was going for the big guy over here.
Yeah, well, and they used to be more ensemble-type films, so it wouldn't necessarily need to be, because Hugh Jackman just sells tickets because he's a great actor, and he's also a good-looking fella, all right? If you got Wolverine and it wasn't, like, the best-looking version of him, and he was kind of the linchpin of your franchise, might not do as well, but that's when, back in the day, they used to have, like, Halle Berry and, Ian McKellen, Patrick Stewart, not necessarily those are bombshells, but they were, like, Famke Janssen back in the day, and all that stuff, but and then now more so with Jennifer Lawrence, kind of bringing in the pretty back, or James McAvoy, Michael Fassbender, but this Wolverine, I still really love him. If it's the last time we see him, I think that's okay. But we finally got to see him really not even just swear, but just start ripping people apart.
And why the hell is there a clone of him?
Yeah, all right, Joe, let's get to it. One of the worst things about this film is the villains. That last thing right there that you just said. Why didn't they just get Liev Schreiber back? Bums me out, man. That was not that cool. I hate doppelgangers. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, but I think Sabretooth also had a mutant pride. I don't think that he would stoop as low as to work for the people that are trying to eradicate him.
He might if he gets another crack at good old Jimmy. That's what he'd say. I don't know. He's done some bad stuff in the past. I would just love to see him back because I think he's an excellent actor. And that was one of the best parts of Origins, was their back and forth. I could watch a whole movie just on those two guys, and they're going through all the wars and stuff like that. But I thought that last villain was kind of a lackluster, even though he looks great, I'm thinking, oh, wow, you're looking pretty good, buddy. But it just wasn't compelling at all to me.
The mercenary with the robot hand, what did you think about him? I thought he was a good actor, played the part well. I didn't see any downfall to it, but
he's just, again, it wasn't very compelling. It wasn't very interesting. He's just very straightforward and generic. He did play the part well, but he wasn't really cool. Like, he didn't really do anything where I thought, oh man, that guy's really neat. I just don't know why Logan didn't kill him when he had the chance, because he has a great chance to do it. Knocks the dude out. Why doesn't he's at this point now? Why would he not?
That's a good point. Why
he just rip him apart? He'd be like,
he kills all the guys trying to steal the freaking wheels off his limo, but he won't even take a strike at this guy. He just knocks him out. Come on.
Yeah, cowman, why don't you go bury him somewhere? It's like, dude, gut him.
You
just
stupid.
Gut him.
Like a fish.
He's thinking, like, the producers were writing it down, or the script writer, and said, let's just say he had a moment where he didn't kill someone.
All right, script meeting. So we're to the point where the guy shows up at their pad in Mexico. Wolverine, Logan, he knocks him out. What does he do next? He kicks him again, and he tells the guy to take him off into the desert.
Yeah. Yeah, it's unfortunate.
You really think that's what he'd do, Mike? Oh, he's Wolverine. I know that's what he'd do. No, Wolverine would go crazy and kill him.
Speaking of that, though, Laura, or X-23,
yeah,
how cool was she doing all that stuff, especially that Arkham style kind of like taking the dudes out in the warehouse, that whole sequence where they're looking for her and she's like ripping them apart.
Well, yeah, she was good. She really was. I guess
intimidating.
Got a good young actress. Yes. Played so the role good. Very well. If she was really doing some of those moves, good on her.
Yeah, I don't know if it was some wire work or anything like that, but it was very well done for the budget, too, because they took a hit in budget for it. But I thought she was well cast, and she acted very well for someone who didn't really talk too much. She did very, very well.
No, and that was well done. I didn't want her to talk a lot, you know. And it was weird, you know. They used DNA, and they grew the mutant children and Mexican women's bellies or whatever. They like said that line. I was like, weird.
Yeah, that part's strange, because then they think of Logan, and then my thought, if I were Logan, would be, who is this poor woman who gave birth to that or whatever? It's rough. It's rough stuff. But
I'll tell you what, it did, you know, they did a good job with the, you know, the phone film or video from the nurse. And what I'm about to show you is illegal, yada, yada. And it's like, she's like everywhere.
No one's like, stopping her.
No one stopped her from filming all this, huh?
Yeah.
And, they did a good job of giving that weight and, you know, making it seem pretty horrid and, you know, tugging on the heartstrings a little bit, like, wow, that's horrible sort of a deal. It was cool. And I don't know.
Joe, I got another question for you.
Yeah.
Sorry to cut you off, but we're talking about the violence and stuff, which is really good. It's kind of nice to see this character finally get to do this type of thing, because in X2 we saw him kind of do something similar to these SWAT guys, but it wasn't exactly the same, because when you have those claws, you can kind of stick them in a dude and scream at him, but he doesn't need to be like gushing with blood. But this one, there were a few times when he was like running it through people's jaws and you would see it in their mouth. They're like, oh,
yeah. Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, awesome. And when he's running through the forest after he takes that serum, and he's like, and he's like, and he's just launching at him and killing him. It was awesome. Great action. Well done for the budget. My one gripe, however, the thing that annoys me about that is that you always, when you go to a theater, I love when like it's a comedy and people kind of chuckle. But this was rated R, and there was a lot of killing. Like, it was gruesome. Like, there was some stuff in there where it was like, shit, you know, like severed heads, etc. You talked about running through the jaw, you know, slicing like this. Awesome. It's what Wolverine should be. It's what you expect with a guy that has freaking razor sharp knives in his hands. But it annoys me when you got that, you know, that nerdy 19-year-old that is awkward and decides he's gonna chuckle at every horrid death scene he sees.
Oh, really? I had people in my audience going, oh, like this. They would all go together. Ah.
Yeah, okay, I get that. But then you got these two in the back here that are just like, every time somebody gets just sliced up and just mutilated, it's like, I'm scared to know what you're going to do after seeing this movie, buddy.
Yeah,
where's your mind?
The most
your maturity.
Yeah, the most I ever did was I smiled because it was just nice to see this character finally come to fruition on the screen.
Sure,
it wasn't unhindered, but I wasn't. Oh, look at him! He lost his arm.
I mean, I get that it's like intense and it's awesome. It's like finally they're kind of doing the character justice. He's really, you know, we're seeing what he's actually doing instead of, you know, you hear him run the knives through and they do kind of a cut to something else. It was great, but grow up.
Yeah, theater etiquette. I know I had a guy when Caliban does the thing with the grenades, he says, like, beware the light. Some guy was like clapping. He's like, dude, all right. Really? I don't care if this is some sort of comic pull. You know what? Just calm down. Some of these people are just so, my gosh.
Some people are a little over the top, and it bugs me a little bit. But, I mean, I understand passion for a movie, but that was like –
yeah.
I'm nervous to know what he's got in his basement. You know, some chains and maybe a dead body. I don't know.
That's super good. You know, we were talking about the action, and I kind of had a problem with this, Joe. I don't know if you did, but sometimes there were two scenes that were shot at night when they were fighting. And once in a while, it was kind of difficult for me to tell because they would do such quick cuts, you know, to another thing, who exactly was getting stabbed or slashed. I don't know if you had that problem at all, if you were able to kind of keep it, you know, together.
So I was sitting in like the fourth row. So I was close. Like, if a character walked in stage left, I was like, you know, peering around. It wasn't bad, though. You know, it wasn't like a 3D movie where you're just like
vomiting everywhere.
You know? And you notice that 3D movies are a little darker, so it's kind of hard to see things. I noticed that a lot. Like, the brightness of the film itself, with or without the glasses, is not there. So it's kind of shady. But this one wasn't too bad. There wasn't a heck of a lot of shaky cam because they could show everything. It was pretty well done. There was a point or two where it got a little intense. Like, I know you're talking about the farm scene where he's fighting the clone.
Right before that, when he's fighting those other guys too, I think there's some stuff that happened faster. I thought,
one too, they just want to give you the effect that he's just like instantaneously like slaughtering them all, whatever. But I don't know. Like, who? Xavier, why listen to that jag off? I mean, let's go have a meal with this family and, you know, stay the night.
Like, gets them all killed, which is pretty funny.
You get this whole family killed. Nice people, you stupid mother trucker. Like,
that probably hit hard with you because there were a bunch of farmers, and I remember thinking, oh, this is Joe's not gonna like.
I thought it was interesting the nods they did to future by showing for the corn and stuff, and then they talk about it's in everything you drink, the corn syrup or whatever, you know, everybody killing everybody. Whatever.
We forgot to mention that too, that's what's going on, is they, to get rid of all the mutants, they put a bunch of stuff in all the food so that way it would kind of stop the mutant gene. So that's why there's like no mutants anymore. So
but the smart mutants are vegan and they eat only whole organic foods, and
just like Logan.
They're doing it.
You know, one last thing I want to talk about, besides the one of the last scenes there, which I thought, I kept thinking, you'd be fine, you're okay, walk it off, is it kind of reminded me of the Darth Vader hallway scene where he gets in front of X-23 and he says, you know, get behind me, and they both charge together and they start taking dudes out left and right. That scene got me jacked, man. I was like, let's do this, let's kill them all, every last one of them, butcher every last one. It's a good movie, but Joe, you know, on a scale of 1 to 10, where do you rate it, pal? What are you thinking?
Mainly because I'm not super invested in the X-Men franchise. I only give it about an 8.
Okay.
You know, I walked out of it knowing Hugh Jackman did an excellent job. They did do justice to the character. The new characters were pretty good. The villain wasn't over the top. It wasn't. You could tell it wasn't the main focus of the movie. You know, they were focusing more on Logan.
You know, that trio.
All right. Spoiler, the biggest spoiler of them all, Logan dies. We all knew it going in. We all knew it going in, even though I was holding out hope for maybe they would like transfer his consciousness to his clone.
Oh, that would have been sweet. He's thinking, ooh, yeah. Hello.
I thought, why else would they bring a clone into this? Like, obviously, somehow they're going to transfer Xavier's going to do something crazy, right?
Oh, cool. That's a great ending. I like that one, that he would have died to do that. Idea. Oh, Joe, I like that idea. Way better. Okay, anyway, keep going. I'm sorry.
I could write this shit. Anywho, where was I?
You
know, a good strong eight. Everything was good. It just wasn't, you know, it's not your typical epic proportions such as a Marvel Avengers film, you know, or it's better than something like Suicide Squad for sure. Like Suicide Squad tries to be epic, but it can't. This movie stays in its lane, and its primary focus is to do justice to the characters that are coming to an end, sort of a deal. And I think they achieved that quite well. The dialogue parts are good.
Yeah, they're great.
Good development throughout the movie with that as a base. And then the action is intense. Gets your blood pumping. You're like, oh shit. Like, yeah.
And it's not too over the top either. That's the other thing.
Yeah, it's not hokey crazy stuff. You know, it's legit what you would expect. Still don't know why those kids didn't help out a little more.
They're scared, Joe. They're really terrified.
Yeah, they're like, I don't know what to do. What's the number for 911?
Just keep running. Keep running, kids. Yeah. I just wish we could see that the trio again in another film, because I could just watch those guys travel across the country for a few more films just hanging out together.
Sure. Okay, and so was the safe haven real?
We don't know. We don't know. Apparently, it had to be real to some extent because they were talking to somebody on the radio, unless it was a government facility that was just collecting them. It's like the old Jedi Purge. Come on back to Coruscant. It's fine. You don't mind the smoke, you know?
I didn't quite, you know, I assumed it must have been legit. They were talking to somebody on the radio, but I would have liked to have seen something.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, and it didn't have to be like them walking through the front door. It could have just been like a glimpse at the end to show that they made it somewhere. I don't know.
I think the problem
who's to say that group isn't going to keep chasing them across the border?
Most of them are dead. I think most of the people were all paying dead, them for
dead. I mean, you know, the rest of them they send another crew covertly to go get them and retrieve them in Canada. Who's to say they wouldn't do that? Oh, that border. The border is lava.
I think the reason they didn't show it at the end, though, Joe, even if it is real, is because the film isn't about that. It's about Wolverine as a character. And I think that ending shot, especially kind of showing that off, saying like, this is his film, you know, to show that at the end might kind of belittle that. People would say, why do I don't care about this, you know?
But one thing about the ending that made it really good was that when Laura turns around and goes to the grave and turns the cross on its side to make an X.
I knew they were going to do it, and I was so happy that they did it, because it could have been really bad, but it was so good. And then that's just the last thing you see, and it's just like,
it was almost as good as the Paul Walker Vin Diesel drive away.
It's way better than that.
I'm kidding. It was really good. It was
brilliant. Oh, I'm trying to imagine a world where Hugh Jackman isn't alive and they had to make this final movie about him and have a set. Oh my gosh, I would have been bawling in the theaters if that was the last Hugh Jackman and he was like, you know, Paul Walker, exactly the same thing. That would have been CGI. Hugh Jackman would have been weird. Anyway, but yeah, no. So you give an 8 out of 10. That's pretty solid review. But
if you want to see what Jimmy gave it, go check out his review the Critical Reviews YouTube channel.
Dang, Joe, you're getting so good at this. You don't even need me to talk about it. But yeah, check it out, guys. Let us know what you thought of the film down below, or what, if you haven't seen it, if what you're most excited about for it. You know, for me, I know it sounds kind of sadistic, but the ability to have him be violent and kind of swear and do all this stuff, it's just more like the character. And I think that's a beautiful thing. I don't think that every film and every superhero is R-rated, so don't just because Deadpool and Wolverine do well, or Logan, don't make everybody. I don't need R-rated Iron Man or something like that.
Yeah, so, I still thought something was gonna keep him going, like somehow he was gonna, you know, that serum was gonna rejuvenate him to beyond belief. Like his hair changed. I could have swore he looked younger after he took it when he was running through the woods.
Well, they also cut up his beard a little bit, so he had the chops back. That looked
yeah, cool. But I could have swore he looked like he rejuvenated or looked younger.
Maybe, yeah.
I was like, all right, he's back! Yeah! Well,
it's like that video you sent me, too, where they had to recapture like voice acting from him, so they show him doing that whole sequence running through the woods, and he has to
booth
be...
And he's doing the... and he's like yelling, and he's just watching himself on the screen, and he's putting his voice over the actions. That was kind of neat.
I will say this. I know we've already done opinion yell, but I think he has the greatest yell of any superhero that we've had to date yet. He's that when he screams when he stabs somebody, it's like, oh, you feel it.
Yeah. I tell you what, there's weight to it. What was the you said before I went to go see this movie? You said that there's something in there you're really gonna like, Joe. You're gonna love it. I'm not gonna tell you what it is, and then
probably the violence. No, what was it? I don't know what it was. I don't know. Maybe it was the farm stuff. I thought you would have liked the farm things, like being on the farm.
Didn't mean to put you on the spot. I was just curious if it was.
Yeah, I'll think back to it. If I can think of it, I'll let you know. But you know, Logan, he kills a lot of people. Joe kills a ton of them. Lots bodies on bodies on bodies.
Quite the body count. If I ever rewatch it, which I may do, I will count them all. And for every death, I will take a drink.
Oh my gosh. What I was going to say is we don't kill people. We just kill time, Joe. What are those things that we, what do we, what is it called? What do we call
them?
Those
Jimmy, things? I believe those things are called time killers.
That's right. It's time for time killers. It's the games we've been playing, the movies we've been watching, the TV shows we've been viewing, and the superheroes we've been thinking about. We'd say cookbooks, but it's a special week. Anyway, also at the very end of that, Hugh Jackman, 17 years. Thank you so much. Fantastic work. So good. Before we get to our time killers, Joe, I asked the Legionnaires kind of what they've been killing time with, because it's not always just about us, about them too. So here we got a few things for feedback. Ice Boot says,
Jimmy, so what I've been killing time with.
Ice Boot says she's been playing Pokemon Moon. Good choice. Kimberly Ingram and the hashtag
is pause. That is how Pokemon is supposed to be played.
Oh, there you go. I'm with you there, Joe. I'm not going to fight you on that. But Kimberly Ingram and the hashtag is Stardew Valley. Great game. Seems to be going around. Joran Evers, friend of the show. Great friend of the show. XCOM 2 with 2 exclamation points. Got it from my fiance, and I've been playing it nonstop. Such a great game and so inspiring. Definitely recommend it. XCOM 2, baby. Nice. Night Warrior says, watching CSI Las Vegas and playing Pokemon White 2. There you go. Chris McKeek says, Star Trek Online. Really got into it. Love my Intrepid class ship. Oh, Godspeed to you. And Anna said, working on the Wake Up podcast, which we've been working on. And by we, I do also mean me. I'm part of that. And playing Final Fantasy 15. But Joe, they've been killing time with that. What have you been killing time with, man? What have you been doing? What have you been watching?
Well, I think we all know Ghost Recon Wildlands came out, released yesterday.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All about it. Even my girlfriend likes it. We talked about it in the opinion section here in the podcast. Great game. If you're into that sort of thing, very realistic shooter, kind of real world style. And also spending time with your buds, strategizing, sinking shots, you know, or just taking down as many as you can before they can pull the trigger, whatever.
Yeah, I was gonna say, Joe, don't tell these people that you've been sinking shots, because I know you're like, all right, get ready for 1 and 2. I took out 1. I also took out 2.
Listen, I'm just impatient. If I see 2 is still up and I just shot 1, I'm going for 2.
Other people have to get a chance to shoot people, Joe. You have to be considerate.
We need to up the itch on your trigger finger.
The best is when Joe and I both go for a sink shot. We both miss, and then we both say, I missed that guy. Oh, yeah, I missed my guy, too. They're all on us. It's like, oh, God.
And then immediately we try, well, you missed first, so I blame you.
My guy's got an iPad, so his depth perception isn't always so good. So that's
We constantly blame it on that.
That's what I do.
Yeah. See, we're having fun with that game. Good time with the buds. It's also a good solo play. The AI is pretty decent, I would say. You know, and there's a whole command structure that you can give for them to hold position or move to certain spots.
They're crack shots.
And they also follow your sync shots and that sort of thing. So it's pretty cool.
I think so. Anyway. Yeah.
Besides that, you know, saw Logan, killed a little time on Sunday with the matinee on that one. Also, for anybody out there, a matinee is not always the best time to see a movie.
Yeah, it can be nervous.
Unfortunately, you don't normally get the normal folk at that time. It's normally...
Weekday matinees are better, but, you know, for most people... Well, then you're
generally the only one in there.
Yeah, exactly. That's why it's the best, because you go and you're like, oh, hello.
But when you go in the evening on a weekend night or something with the girlfriend, that's typically the crowd you get. And it's just more comfortable for some reason. When I went on Sunday in the afternoon, it was like 12:30.
Oh, yeah?
And there was just the weirdest of the weird out for some reason, you know? They're killing time on their Sunday afternoon, and they're just a weird group. And but hey, whatever. No judging, I guess. Wait, I'm judging. Whatever. Sorry.
That's okay. I want to say one funny thing. I had a guy walk into our row halfway through the theater or halfway through the movie because he had left and he was sitting in like the back row and we were the second to back row. So he's walking across and everyone in the row is looking at this dude. He's looking around at all the seats where he's like, hey, hey. He's like, ask his friends' names. They're behind us going, hey, Greg, hey. We're up here. He's like trying to sit down on one of the people who's already sitting there. We're all looking at him going, dude, what are you doing? What are you get back there?
Now, were you, giggles. Yeah. Were you at the AMC with the recliners?
I was at the AMC with the recliners. I was all
I love those. Back. I wish we had AMCs over here.
Joe, you need to when you move closer, we're gonna do this all the time. I'm just gonna say get out of here, come on, let's go.
Yeah, I really like those. Anywho, other things I've been killing time with, I'm trying to think. I was watching Archer lately.
Oh, sure.
You know, I've been looking for those shows, like an animated comedy, something just to kill a little time with in the evening before bed sort of a deal. And, you know, for some reason, at first, Archer wasn't quite my thing. And then the more I watched it, it grew on me. Not only is it kind of just that dim-witted fun and sarcasm and sometimes dry humor, but the animation style grew on me. I kind of appreciate the art of it all, you know, that the characters are like marker drawn and very defined, and then you have the almost painted realism for the settings. Mm-hmm. I kind of enjoy it. I think it's a well done show, and you know, I get a few good laughs out of it too with the randomness and whatnot. Yeah, so that's kind of what I've been killing time with, and I guess we're on to you, Jimmy. Let's kill some more time. What do you got?
Cool. You know, like we were just talking about Logan, obviously, and the shows I've been watching right now. I just finished rewatching Fate Zero, and I'm on to Fate's Day Night Unlimited Blade Works. They are two anime that you can find on Netflix if you have them, or I'm sure any other place too. But they are so well done, Joe. They, you know, you're talking about how you like Archer and the look of it. This is what if someone said, Jimmy, can you point to something you've been watching recently that is indicative of what you like to just visually stimulating? Is this show? It is. By far, maybe one of just the most gorgeous anime I've ever seen, or any art form ever. It's just the fighting is so fluid, the effects, all of it comes together, and the story is actually pretty good. I'm always invested in it, and I kind of forgot exactly how it all works because there's kind of some mystery to it too, but very fascinating show about these individuals, these mages who have to come together every so often to fight for the one and only Holy Grail. And if you win this Holy Grail war, as it were, you get one wish. And to assist you with that, you have to summon a servant, which is one of seven different classes. And then they are all former, basically, heroes of renown. So you never know who you're going to get depending on what you summon it with, you know. So it's really cool. And the fighting is just really fascinating and the tactics and all that. So really love that show. Ghost Recon, we're just talking about Wildlands. We've been playing. It's been great. But Horizon Zero Dawn, we'll probably get more into this when I kind of get the review out and stuff. I might gush about it some other time. But seriously, if you have a PlayStation 4 and you like open world games, you have no excuse. It is the best open world game on that console, hands down. It is beautiful. It is fun. It is excellent. Everything's great about it, just about. And yeah, there's only a few little things here and there, but I'll get into that more. But you should definitely check it out. I'm streaming it a lot. It's great.
How much greater would it be if it had a multiplayer aspect?
If it had a multiplayer aspect of any kind, I'd hope it'd be like co-op at most, where you just had a buddy kind of team up with you, and you could like hunt things together. That's where I think maybe the sequel would come in. But because it's the first foray into this brand new IP that Sony's kind of lifting up, I think it's okay to start this way. Plus, I wouldn't want them to take away from the fact that they have a female protagonist and she needs to be, like, they don't need to have, like, oh, and she also has a guy companion or a female companion. It's her story. And I think that it speaks volumes. And also, she's going to be a face for Sony, I think, going forward. I think we're going to think Nathan Drake, Kratos, and Aloy. She's really that. She's very good. She's very well voice acted, too. So, yeah, it's Ashley Birch killing it. So, yeah, that's what I've been killing time with, Joe. But, you know, Joe, after we're done with Time Killers, we always go into the segment called, what is it, Questions and Community Feedback? I believe it is. Mm-hmm. So we'll start with the community feedback. It was Opinion Yell this week, obviously. The quarter yell. Apologies.
All these quells.
Yeah, I know. Jennifer Lawrence is going to come get me. We got one. Not a lot of people want to share their opinions. Maybe we'll get another time. But it's from Nightwarrior. He says, Horizon Zero Dawn. This is hard for me to say. Plot and general gameplay make it one of the biggest failures, in my personal opinion, game-wise, of 2017. Hype's illogical. All right. it's like, but yeah, that's okay. It's not for everybody. I asked him a little bit more about it, and he just said it just wasn't for him. That's totally cool. Anyway, Joe, that gets us into questions. So, Joe, our first question comes in from Chris McKeag, and he was just asking me about how I review games. He wanted to know. He said he could ask a bunch of questions about it, but he just wanted to ask my method. Basically, Chris, this is how I do it. I go through, and depending on the game, I try to get through the entirety of the campaign. I play some side missions and stuff like that. While I go through, if I think there's going to be something cool or I anticipate it, I try to capture the footage then and there. If not, I'll go back after the campaign's done and capture some other things there. Kind of go through it, try to write down my thoughts and think about how the game is affecting me and what I like about it, the shortcomings there are, but all the little nuances that I love about the game, too. So it is kind of a process, and I don't want to rush through it, especially with an RPG. I don't want to just say, hey, I've only played 20 hours and it's this great, because what if the next 20 hours or even the last 20 minutes might be like horrendous, you know? It's something to consider, so I don't like to rush things out. That's why it takes time with RPGs. With For Honor, I could play the campaign in a weekend and play through a bunch of the multiplayer and give it a review and a score, but with this something like Horizon Zero Dawn, it takes a little bit of time. So thank you for being patient. And if you want any more in-depth analysis about how the reviewing process works, please let me know. I'm happy to do that. Because then I go through it, write it all down, record it, and then put all the clips together with the recording. And yeah, it's a big, I'm a one-man band, as it were. Anyway, Anna, a question, Joe, from Anna. This is a pretty interesting one. It's post-apocalypse. You bring one tool with you to start out. No weapons of any kind. What do you bring? Joe, I'm interested. What do you bring? What do you bring with you to this post-apocalypse? Apocalypse. Lips. He's stumped.
Tool of any kind, but no weapons.
Yeah.
Post-apocalypse?
It sounds like an anime right now, because that's usually what they do is they repeat.
Well, I'm thinking, okay, post-apocalypse, I'm going to, pillage things. Like, there's things left over? Or are we talking, like, the whole planet is now a desert, desolate?
Whole planet is now a desert, desolate. Yeah. I don't know. She never said it.
Well, I'm going to die pretty quickly because there's nothing to eat.
All right. This is what's going to help you survive, Joe. I don't know. She never said it couldn't be fictional, but I was thinking one of those cloaks from, not the invisibility cloak, but the cloak from Lord of the Rings, those elven cloaks. They could kind of serve as to keep me warm, but then I could also look like a rock if I needed to. When the scavengers come and try to murder me, I'm like, I'm a rock. I don't know. She's like, please don't kill me. That would be my choice.
Oh, my God. I would bring a baseball bat to bash my own brains in so I don't have to live through it.
How about you just bring like a shovel and then you try to
spit? Yeah, I'll bring a shovel so I can dig my own grave and then bash my head in with the shovel so I don't have to live through it.
Oh my gosh, a shovel to dig your own grave. I just see you standing at the top of the pit and then just like hitting yourself as hard as you can and just falling backwards. Oh, Joe. That's
pretty Yeah. Cool. Yeah. Or if we compare it to that movie, what was it, Martian? The Martian?
The Martian.
I'd want the space station, you know, with all the things in it.
I don't think that's one item. You can't have a space station.
But even then you go insane and just kill yourself. So either way, something to kill myself with, all right?
You'd be the best scientist on Mars, or the greatest, is what I was trying to say, because you'd be up there and they say, Joe, you can science your way out of this or whatever, and you'd say, no, I'm going to try to kill myself. I'm going to walk outside and take the helmet off.
I'm going to find a cliff and I'm going to jump. I'm going to do it.
Next question. All right, Joe, this is from our longtime friend, Fragadin. This is a good one. Hey, guys, would you rather have a beloved big-name franchise title that is significantly flawed or a very good Kickstarter adaptation of the same franchise? To give an example, Castlevania and Bloodstained. I would love to hear your thoughts. Long live the Legion. Hashtag critical podcast. Thank you so much, Fragadin. I love that. Long live the Legion. That's good.
Nice.
So what would you like? Would you like a big, you know, big like AAA title that's got some flaws to it, or would you rather have something like a Kickstarter adaptation, a little bit smaller, quite a bit smaller, that was pretty solid in the same vein or the same franchise, as it were?
I want the big AAA with some flaws because, let's face it, there's games that have flaws that I love that are big names.
So, I love that. I love that you're
there's nothing. There's nothing that's perfect, and I really don't have much for this one. Sorry to say,
that's fine.
I don't even know what he was talking about in the example. So that's just my inexperience.
That's okay.
Maybe more one for you, Jimmy. So
don't worry about it. I understand where you're coming from. I think depending on what he says, a good Kickstarter, it does seem to kind of swing that way. But I guess if there was an adaptation from a franchise that I wasn't going to get another game from. You know, I'd take the Kickstarter personally. The AAA stuff, they can be very good, but sometimes they can feel hollow. Some of these smaller things can feel like there's a lot of love and time put into them. So it just depends, I guess, on the series, though, too. You know, so I don't know. But good question, all the same, though, Fragment. I really like it. And then our last one here comes in from Night Warrior. It's Echo Critical at Lever _67 hashtag Critical Podcast. You were offered an acting job both as a detective and a criminalist. Which one would you pick? And from which actor would you draw tips and or inspiration? I'm going to hedge you off at the pass, Joe. I'm going to pick something a little different. Everybody's thinking Sherlock Holmes or whatever. They're all thinking that. No. I'm going to be a detective, but I'm going to learn and be Watson. Because I'm not going to know everything, but I'm going to learn. And I'm going to do the Jude Law version from the Sherlock Holmes with Robert Downey Jr. Because I thought he was great in those ones. He had military background. He was picking stuff up. He's kind of an intelligent guy. That's the guy I'd want to. Say, yeah, that's the guy. He's the guy I want to be like, because Sherlock's a jerk. I don't care how intelligent you are. I don't want to be Sherlock. So I wouldn't want to emulate that. So, Joe, would you be? Would you detective or criminalist, and which actor would
What's
you pick?
What's a criminalist?
I think that's more kind of like Criminal Minds, where you kind of are trying to understand the person a little bit more, where you kind of get in the head of like a person like that. I could be wrong. Correct me if I'm wrong, Night Warrior. He's probably typing right now.
I want to be Tom Selleck from Blue Bloods.
Tom Selleck? Oh, Jiminy Christmas, Joe. That's good. That mustache alone. That's what you want to emulate.
Because he has the best mustache in human history. Like, they're going to cut it off and put it in a museum one day.
Oh, wow.
But all the ladies love Tom Selleck.
Good. So as a detective / criminalist or one or the other, that you just want to be loved by the ladies.
Kind of a blend of the two. It's all the best. So.
Is that what he is in Blue Bloods? Is kind of a jack of all trades?
Yeah, what is he? He's the sergeant or the, what are they, captain of the squad, of the force.
Okay, cool. Cool. Sweet. That was a good question, though. I kind of like that one because it makes you think a little bit.
I never really watched the show. I just really like Tom Selleck. He's a badass.
Joe just wants to be Tom Selleck. I don't blame him. well, Joe, believe it or not, I think that's the show for this week. You know, I want to just tell people, first off, if you have any questions for us, all you have to do is tweet the hashtag Critical Podcast right up here to either one of us. I am at Go Critical. That is capital G with a capital C. Or you can tweet at Joe.
At Lever _627. That's Lever just like Beaver, only with an L.
I wish we could get an animation for that Beaver or Lever just like Beaver.
You got to get a Beaver in there.
He's like chewing down a log. It turns into an L. I don't know. Anyway, but I also want to thank this is Daleb for our, that'd be cool. This is Daleb for our theme music and obviously Yoren Evers for our fantastic thumbnails and artwork. If you see any of this here, you can tweet at him and ask him about some because he does commissions over at Jade Circle Art. Just tell them Jimmy and Joe sent you. So, yeah, we thank everybody for tuning in. Thank you for everyone who's tuning in for, you know, the second or maybe even the 50th time by now, or for the people who've tuned in for the first time. Thank you. If you want to help support us, the best way you can do it is just share with a friend or just tell us what you want to see in the future, what you want to see us cover. So,
yeah. Happy 50th, Jimmy.
Well, happy 50th to you too, Joe. You know, in a couple of weeks, we're going to be at that year mark. It's going to be great.
That's something. That is something.
Yeah, man, it's been a wild ride. But thank you so much, Joe. I really appreciate it. And to all of the Legionnaires, all I have to say is adapt and overcome. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.